Yeah. My ambitions as a rider, nigga. Surviving off that powder, nigga. Currently smoking that kill in the hills where you can't find a nigga. Crack cocaine, microwave. Dinner was on that timer, nigga. No sleep, bags under my eyes is designer, nigga. Blinded and misguided, nigga. Heavenly Father, take the wheel. I'm on the interstate, with some gorilla, but shit, nigga, give me like 20 years. Stuck in the pen, I need forgiveness. I'm living like every decision is sin. I know my niggas don't want me to win. Jealousy chopping off all of my friends. I ride with that white, white, just like Fight Night, we be waiting in. BDS, my piece is 20, caring Jesus, say amen. Stripped off on my new bitch, she was half black, give me an AGN. Spent my last 200,000 on a burden of a shady bin. My dog used to pull up in the 99 GS300. Fresh up off that highway with that higher power, how you voting? First these hoes ain't holding, now they on it, had to fight and blow it. Mama said you didn't go to devil, you live in the moment. I be kicking shit like Solange in the elevator to go. We tried to kick that dope, stuck on the respirator. Got symptoms of withdrawal from the fall, when I used to fall. I show you how in one summer, one nigga could lose it all. Like why we gotta feel the pain in the friends and family don't. My city like to walk around in the sleep, I'd rather stay woke. I must devote these are the results of the realest shit that I wrote. These hoes get in the way and burn that ass quick like galaxy notes. That's why I ride with that white white just like Fight Night, we be weighing in. PDF, my piece is 20, Kevin, Jesus, say amen. Tricked off on my new bitch, she was that black and an AGN. Spent my last 200,000 on a burden of Mercedes Benz. My dog used to pull up in the 99 GS300. Fresh up off the highway with that higher power. How you want it? First these hoes ain't want it, now they on it. Had the Michael Jordan. Mama said you live next door to devil, you live in the moment. I be kicking shit just like Robin did the cameraman. I'm pure 100 dope like the poppy seed in Afghanistan. I've been to drop my nuts for this cabbage hands. Do damage, nigga. Rips from the cliff, leave you stiff. Man, it get challenged, nigga. Need my chips with info, ain't no play, play about that beetle. Try to give me 10, I'm beating.
Black power. Peace, power, and respect. We are back again. Back on live. If you tuned into my story, you saw the justification. Or the reasoning behind my going live once again tonight, discussing electoral politics, primarily as it pertains to the treatment of black male, specifically cisgender heterosexual black male political participation. As I said in my story, right, the circus has gone on unchecked for far too long, and I'll sort of explain what that means, sort of as, you know, we dive into what we're talking about, and also, as I stated in my story, right, the constant objective, whether it's going live, whether it's reading, studying, you know, engaging in conversation with peers, all actions are sort of baked on this foundation that, you know, we intend to dispel myths and disrupt pathology with data, empirical findings, and real scholarship, right? And some will ask, you know, what about lived experience? Lived experience is data. Lived experience is countable and is eligible, I guess is a better term. Right, to be considered as data, but it certainly does not encompass the end-all be-all social facts about our people and our conditions, right? And so that's why I say we're here to dispel myths and disrupt pathology using data, empirical findings, and real scholarship and real research, because we are far too complex of a people to fall under the assumption that simply relying on our own personal lived experiences will actually garner, right, mass and systemic solutions to our conditions and to our problems. And again, that isn't to disparage or discredit or discount anybody's lived experiences or anyone's real trauma or real pain. It's real. You can't disparage what is real. Again, the priority is placed on, right, asking those questions that will garner the proper conversations and dialogue, right, in order to garner those mass solutions to our problems, right? It would be a logical fallacy for anybody, myself included, right, to think my own Makona Tendaji's personal lived experiences are efficient as the sole contribution to, right, data and scholarship and research, right? And that just isn't the case. You know, so again, by disrupting myths and or by dispelling myths and disrupting pathology, data and empirical findings are necessary. I won't spend a whole lot of time talking about this particular topic, just because it's so it's sort of ballooned into such a for lack of a better term, a circus. You see it nearly every day. There's another black celebrity said this, or another black academic tweeted this about black men, or, you know, it's seemingly daily, and it's certainly not going to slow down as we approach, right, November 3rd. And you know, subsequently, it will not cease after. Matter of fact, as a sort of preface to what I'm going to talk about, I like to pull up just this real simple and brief statement. One of the good brothers that I'm tapped into on social media, Omwale Africa, this is on Facebook, and he says, let me pull it up right here. He said that regardless, he said, this is his early election prediction. He says, regardless of who wins, black men will be blamed in regards to the election. He said that if Biden loses the election, black men will be blamed for his loss, right? For not showing up to the polls, as they like to call it, right? He says, if Biden wins the election, black men will be called misogynist for not showing up for Hillary Clinton in the same way. Damned if we do, damned if we don't, cursed if we won't. And really what he's articulating, or he's really underlining, is the very, very deep anti-black misandric themes and views, right, that really permeate the electoral political landscape, right? But I'm not going to get into, you know, rhetoric or semantics too much. So for everyone who's tuned in now, and for those who will tune in afterwards, a large majority of everything that I'll be sort of sharing as data or sources, I have compiled into a document, a Google document, right? I'm not just, you know, speaking from my rear end when I say these things, right? So at the end of this, or, you know, you can indicate so at whatever point in time, you can DM me or whatever, if you'd like access to view this document, where I cite my sources and where there's actually data charts that really demonstrate, right, the problems that I'm speaking to. So first and foremost, anti-black misandry. What is that, right? There's certainly a term I was not aware of up until maybe 2 years ago. And even when I was first introduced, it wasn't like I was given the full comprehensive definition, right? So let's go ahead and define that term here. Anti-black misandry is defined as misandry that describes the specificity racism acquires when it is directed at black men and boys, whereas black male vulnerability expresses the actual disadvantage and violence that black males suffer as both black and male. Racist misandry expresses the vulnerability black men and boys have to the obsessive hatred society directs towards them, right? In this sense, racist misandry not only expresses the pathological aversion that society holds towards black males, but it also names the ontological program that is constantly operating to socialize the public into believing that, given the savage nature of black men and boys, the various cruelties and stereotypes used to dehumanize them are accurate. Even within the academy, misandry functions to make the sociological condition of black men and boys synonymous with their being, thereby making it necessary to morally condemn and sanction them to preserve civility and order in society. In other words, the black male is theorized as deserving and necessitating the repressive forces set against him. This comes directly from the one of the pioneers, you would say, of black male studies, right? Dr. Tommy J. Curry himself in his book, The Man Not. Right. Again, everything that I'm reading, that I'm sort of speaking towards, is on a document. So, you know, if you might, you know, you want to read it for yourself, please just let me know and I'll send it your way. Again, I'm not just, you know, I'm not just talking nice just to do so. You know, this is a complex and a serious issue. So I'm adopting a complex and a serious approach to the issue. Right. So the primary, component of this topic of electoral politics that I really, really want to cover is the seemingly growing or the amplified issue, right? I put that in quotes of black men demonstrating a support for the current president, Donald Trump, right? And the reason why I put that in quotes is because the data demonstrate very, very clearly that the gender gap in terms of support for Trump, as opposed to, you know, disapproval of Trump, that gender gap is extremely exaggerated and hyper-fixated, actually. So there are several news articles, several data points that I really want to hone in on. And again, it isn't the goal of myself or anybody who is a student of black male studies to redirect the pathology to another group, right? So I don't sit and study, right, the conditions of black men and the pathology of black men to then sort of remove it from our shoulders and place it upon somebody else's, right? That isn't the goal with black male studies as a discipline, nor is it my personal goal as a scholar, right? The goal, again, is to dispel myths and to disrupt pathology, right? That I think that one of the biggest disputes that people sort of put upon or they, you know, project towards black male studies is, oh, you don't want to be held accountable, or, you know, you mistake hatred for accountability, or, you know, that's a buzzword on social media these days, accountability, right? And that isn't true, right? Again, very real experiences, very real trauma, and very real pain is exchanged, right, in a bi-directional way in our communities, right? Black male studies is simply the sociological an empirical intervention, right, into studying, right, the conditions and problems that plague black men. Mother Tahaka, he asks, right, what is pathology? Excellent question. Let me not just, again, talk out of my rear end, because that isn't what we do. So let me pull that up. And again, I'm going to sound like a broken record, but I'm going to keep saying it. Everything that I'm referring to, right, whether it's this poll or this data set or this article, right, there's a all that's compiled on a document, right, that I've put together. And for anyone that is, you know, interested in viewing that, just let me know, and I will share that with you. So again, the question is, what is pathology? Let me pull this up here. It's giving me all these complex science biological definitions, but again, I don't want to misspeak. Let me see. What is pathology? Let me see. And actually, I spoke about this on my last live, right? So when we talk about pathologizing a group or an individual, right? It's when you obscure the systematic and institutional ways in which that person's life is altered or harmed, right? And you simply assign blame to that individual person's character or morality, right? So to pathologize, I have a definition right here, is to regard or treat someone or something as psychologically abnormal or unhealthy, right? And so when we use this term pathology, right, it's describing the overly simplified assignment of blame to black men. And so what you'll get is, you know, let's say a current event occurs dealing with a black man, and this is a hypothetical, right? Let's say it's an intimate partner violence incident, right, involving a black man and another person, right? Without any sort of interrogation of the actual incident, immediately you will see the overwhelming themes of the discourse will revolve around, oh, this toxic masculine black man, this you know, this hyper masculine, hyper violent black man, right? There is no attempt to actually get down to the root causes and conditions that really, you know, breeded this type of an incident, right? And that's what it means, again, to pathologize someone is to regard or treat them as psychologically abnormal or unhealthy. This does not happen to any other group more than it happens to black men and boys, right? Getting down to the basis of the discussion, again, electoral politics, more specifically dealing with the gender gap between black men and black women in terms of approval of President Donald Trump, and on the flip side, disapproval, right? And what I argue is that there is a hyper-fixation on this gender gap, and the data clearly demonstrate the gender gap is not as far or as wide, right, as mainstream media, right, black academics, black celebrities are propagating it to be. And there's really, again, it's a real simple solution to really, you know, countering this hyperfixation and really disrupting this pathology, right? So let me pull up this one article released by the Pew Research Center, right, entitled "The Changing Racial and Ethnic Composition of the U.S. Electorate," right? And this, again, this is all a document that I've compiled, and it's, you know, got the links on there. So if you want access to that, just let me know. So in this article is discussing the ways in which the they call it the U.S. electorate. So it's basically the body of eligible voters in the U.S., right? So what this article says is that in all 50 states, the share of non-Hispanic white eligible voters declined between 2000 and 2018, with 10 states experiencing double-digit drops in the share of white eligible voters, right? The article goes on to say that Pew Research Center survey data spanning more than two decades, that's 20 years, shows the Democratic Party maintains a wide and long-standing advantage among Black, Hispanic, and Asian American registered voters, right? So again, to speak or to counter these myths of, oh, there's a growing presence in the Black male support for the Republican Party, right? Or there's this problem of Black men supporting Trump is just on the rise, right? The data that go back 20 years does not demonstrate that. The data does not indicate that, right? For 20 years, Black people, by and large, right, have voted Democrat, right? And again, when you study the as this article is entitled, the changing growth and the shifts in terms of race, ethnicity, gender, right, of the U.S. electorate, you can really see who is voting, who is eligible to vote, and of those eligible voters, where are they sort of, you know, assigning their support. This article goes on, right? The non-white voting population has played a large role in driving growth in the nation's electorate. From 2000 to 2018, the nation's eligible voter population grew from 193.4 million to 233.7 million, an increase of 40.3 million. Voters who are Hispanic, Black, Asian, or another race or ethnicity accounted for more than three quarters, that's 76%, of this growth. So from 2000 to 2 years ago, 2018, right, you have an increase of 40 million people in that eligible voter population. So a very drastic, right, growth, an upsurge in the eligible voting population, right? This is interesting. Listen to this. Hispanic eligible voters were notably the largest contributors to the electorate's rise. They alone accounted for 39% of the overall increase of the nation's eligible voting population. Hispanic voters made up 13% of the overall country's electorate in 2018, nearly doubling that from 7% in 2000. This group's sustained growth over the past 20 years will make Hispanics the projected largest minority group among U.S. eligible voters in 2020 for the first time ever in a presidential election. What this demonstrates is that from 2000 to 2018, the non-white eligible voter population in the United States has grown by 76%, right? Oh, I'm sorry, it's grown by 40 million people. Right. And Hispanic, Black and Asian and other race ethnicities account for 76% of that growth. What this data demonstrates in that growth, in that increase of 40 million, Hispanic eligible voters make up the largest share of that growth. Right. And then it said this year, this presidential election, right, Hispanics are projected to be the largest minority group among U.S. eligible voters for the first time ever. Right. When we analyze data, right, the question or not the question, the objective should not be, what do I think about this data? The question should be, what does this data demonstrate? Because when we ask ourselves that question of what do I think about this data? Right. Us being, you know, flawed human beings. Right. All of us. Right. I'm talking about myself also. When we ask that question of what do I think about this data? Naturally, our brain will look to deduce those conclusions and draw those solutions that sort of support our own position, or they may confirm our own biases, right? That's what we call confirmation bias. I did a video of that on that in my Fundamentals of Critical Thinking and Analysis series. You can tap in on IG to that. So again, the data demonstrate Hispanic eligible voters represent the largest minority group this year for the first time ever, right? Keep that in mind, right? Hold on to that thought, right? So then we talk about this gender gap, right? This gender gap. What is this gender gap? What does this mean, right? Just yesterday, just last evening, there was a panel event put on by the African American Policy Forum, right? Organized by Kimberly Crenshaw. The panelists, let me pull it up because I don't want to forget anyone who participated in that. It was yesterday, again, organized by the African American Policy Forum, right? Organized by Luke Harris, Kimberly Crenshaw. The panelists were Wade Davis, Kiese Lehman, Marlon Peterson, and Alvin Starks, right? Those were the panelists. The title of this panel was Black Men for Trump? Question mark. The Overdue Conversation on Patriarchy and Misogynoir in Black Politics, right? Truthfully, I was only able to listen to this event for about 15 minutes. The pathology was just so pervasive. The ahistorical takes on Black male political participation, it was just, I really couldn't listen to it for very much longer. So you can tap into that if you choose, right? But I bring that up again because you have all of these, all of this discourse, right? So social media primarily, right? And then you have actual programming organized by, you know, prominent black organizations, the African American Policy Forum, right? That's not a small group, right? Putting on this programming that targets this seemingly growing crisis among the black population. Why are so many black men, you know, supporting Trump, right? It's an example, right? This particular panel is an example of this hyperfixation on, right, the black male support, right, for, or the approval, rather, of President Donald Trump, right? So when we talk about the gender gap, what that entails is so within a race or an ethnicity, right, whether it's black, African-American, Asian-American, Latino, Hispanic, whatever it is, right, the gender gap explains the gender or the side of, I approve of the current administration, I'm more than likely going to vote that way. And then the other side says, I disapprove, I'm going to vote to remove that current administration. Those are the lines that are drawn in the sand. The gender gap demonstrates, right, the percentage within a race or an ethnicity, right, where the men vote one way, the women vote another way, right? So this is an article that just came out last week in the New York Times, right, entitled The Latino Gender Gap, right? In this article, they asked the question, why is Trump holding steady with Latinos? There is no one answer, partly because Latinos are such a diverse group, but an important part of the explanation appears to involve gender. Race may get more attention, but gender also plays a huge and growing role in politics. Listen to this. The gender gap, which was virtually zero in the 1960s and 1970s, could reach a record high this year. Recent Times polls of battleground states show the gender gap among Latino voters is 26 percentage points, which is significantly larger than it is among black, white, or Asian voters, right? So I'm going to read the exact percentage points of this of these polls, right? So these polls are conducted by the New York Times and Siena College, right? These are polls of 18 battleground states. Granted, it's not all of the states, right? The data is not perfect, right? But there is no such thing as perfect data, right? These are polls of 18 battleground states since the start of September, right? These percentage points describe, right, the advantage held by Joe Biden by both ethnicity and sex, right? So the gender gap among Latino voters, again, 26 percentage points. Among white voters, 19 percentage points. Among black voters, 14 percentage points. And among Asian and other eligible voters, 7 percentage points. Again, this is not to generalize the data or to, you know, say only this poll matters. No, but it does demonstrate the gender gap certainly is not the largest or the widest, right, among black eligible voters, right? And as I demonstrated earlier, right, with the changing, right, the shifts in the U.S. electorate, right, this year for the very, very first time, it's projected that Latino Hispanic eligible voters will comprise, right, the largest minority group in that eligible voter population for the first time ever in a presidential election. So the question becomes, if that's true about this particular eligible voter group, Latino Hispanic voters, right? They are now the largest minority group in a growing electorate. And in that same group, there is the largest gender gap. The question becomes, why is there a hyperfixation on the black man supporting Trump problem? The data does not demonstrate that the gender gap is growing, right? And in fact, historically, right, the voting patterns have been very, very consistent in terms of race, ethnicity, and gender, right, in terms of where masses of people, where populations sort of align themselves politically and where they and how they vote, right? So here you go. This is according to the Pew Research Center. This article came out on June 2nd, right? Describing the Democratic edge in party identification, right? This is an analysis based on telephone surveys from 2018 and 2019, right? Sizable majorities of Black, Hispanic, and Asian American voters identify with or lean toward the Democratic Party. Among Black voters, 83% identify or lean toward the Democratic Party, compared with just 10% who say they are Republican or lean toward the GOP, right? Again, this is this problem, right, quote unquote, of Black men supporting Trump, right, is not much of a problem. It's actually an indication of the diverse political interests and leanings, right, of Black people in the United States, right, and that's historically consistent, right. What happens is, what contributes to this hyperfixation on this quote unquote problem is the misinterpretation of Black voters as a monolithic voter group, right? There's the assumption that all Black people just think the same, behave the same, hold the same values, therefore they all vote for the same party, for the same candidates. And that just isn't true. Historically, there has never been an indication of Black voters as a monolith, right? So again, for the discourse, for academia, for the celebrity entertainer class, right, to concentrate on this crisis, quote unquote, on this problem, right, is to base that on, right, on an ahistorical take of Black political participation in this country, right? According to an article that came out in The Guardian back in March, on March 5th, right, it says that African Americans are often depicted as a single, unified voting bloc loyal to the Democratic Party. But these blanket characterizations can hide the diversity of their voting habits and preferences, right? Although Black voters remain the backbone of the Democratic base, listen to this, Latinos surpassed African Americans as the largest minority group in 2003. This article contributes to that same point of Latino Hispanic eligible voters are now the largest minority eligible voter group in the U.S., right? It says, this year will mark the first time that Latinos represent the largest minority voting group. Again, if there's another group besides Black voters that is actually the larger minority voting group, and that same group, right, is where the gender gap is the largest, right? Why aren't there panel events and, you know, social media dialogues about that problem? Because the data clearly demonstrate that statistically, right, is the most significant in terms of this topic of the gender gap, right? The mindless support, or the hard to understand support, right? For Donald Trump as opposed to Joe Biden or whoever the Democratic candidate, you know, would be in any given year, right? Again, we can't ask ourselves, what do I think about this data, or do I agree with this poll, or do I agree with this narrative? We are flawed greatly. That doesn't make us inferior or unintelligent. It makes us human. With that humanity, we also need to adopt the recognition of those flaws and not simply consume the latest Twitter trending topic. Oh, 50 Cent endorsed Trump just today. Lil Wayne, right, met with Donald Trump. They took a picture together. He endorsed him. What does this mean? Right, we really need to do our best to, again, accept those mental flaws, right? Those logical fallacies that sometimes we employ in order to protect ourselves and our interests and our mentality, right? And again, not ignore them or take them as an indication of our lack of intelligence. No. We just need to be sure we are being as thorough as possible when discussing any condition, any issue, any topic having to do with our people. Because, as you see, the circus that is electoral politics plays off that sensationalism. It plays off that very emotional, short attention span you know, just throw out headlines, throw out pictures, throw out quotes, right? Throw out just random percentages with no type of context. It's clear the degree to which, right, the powers that be hold the bar, right, or the expectation in terms of the intelligence or the mental capacity for the masses of black people, right? And you see it. It's a circus, literally, right? You have black celebrities and entertainers that come out with these, you know, very sensationalized, you know, events. An example would be Diddy in his Vote or Die t-shirts, right? They do a very thorough job in infantilizing us a certain way, right? And what I mean by that is treating the masses, right, of eligible voting, you know, people, right, populations, like children, right? All we do is, you know, put on a dope event where Beyonce and Jay-Z are the main performers, and oh, Beyonce and Jay-Z, you know, perform at this Hillary Clinton rally, maybe I should vote for Hillary Clinton, right? They demonstrate clearly, right, what they think about our intelligence and what they think about us. It's our job not just to point that out and say, hey, do better. No. We need to ensure that we are being just as, if not more so, right, intellectually thorough and formidable, right, in the research of our people, right? Again, this document that I put together with all these different sources did not take very long. Sure, it took some time and some energy, some willpower, right? But again, we all are, we all possess the fortitude, right, as a resilient people, as an African people, right, to do for ourselves, right? That's what our ancestors fought for, right? So again, let me just sort of reiterate the major points that I was kind of, you know, that was the intention of going live tonight. There's a hyperfixation on the black male support for Donald Trump. It's this growing issue. It's a crisis, right? The African-American policy forum is putting on a panel and saying this is an overdue conversation, right? The data going back decades demonstrate no deviation from the general historically consistent voting patterns among different minority populations, right? For the last 20, 30, 40 years, generally, black people voted Democrat, right? And they have, right? That isn't to demonstrate black people as a monolith saying, oh, 100% of black people who voted Democrat. No, right? We're not a monolithic people in any way, shape, or form. It's certainly not in the realm of political participation, right? So that's point one and two, right? Point number three, in terms of, again, not simply reassigning the myths or the pathology to, you know, off of black men to black women or to, no, that's not what we're doing. Again, we're interrogating the data and the scholarship, right? To actually devise to construct, right, where the real problems lie. And then from there, devise the solutions to then solve those problems, right? We're not going to solve the problem of black men supporting Trump by hosting panel events because the data do not demonstrate that as a statistically significant problem. Again, Latino Hispanic eligible voters represent the largest minority group among the eligible voter electorate nationally. It's that same group of eligible voters where the gender gap is the widest, right? The gender gap among black eligible voters is 14 percentage points, and it's been that way consistently, give or take 1 or 2 percentage points, for the last 20 years. We are concentrating, not concentrating, we are creating problems, right, in order to justify our pathological views of black men, right? Campaigns are organized in the state of Georgia, right? Where the literal name of the campaign is Get Your Booty to the Pole. And it's these black women as strippers, right? Who are dancing on poles and, you know, doing what they do. And then they end up being the spokespeople for, you know, voter registration and voter education, right? With a very specific targeting of black men. Georgia is a largely black, right, populated state, right? If these types of campaigns and these programs, such as the African American Policy Forum panel, right, yesterday evening, demonstrate nothing else, they demonstrate the very pervasive, right, anti-black misandry that is embedded in electoral politics, right? The data does not demonstrate the gender gap between black men and black women voting. It doesn't demonstrate any sort of growth. It's been about the same for the past 20 years, right? The real growth is among Latino eligible voters, who also are the largest minority voting group. Why is there no pressure being applied in that area? Why are there no panels or campaigns that target Latino men and say, hey, don't vote for Trump, vote for, you know, the Democrats? Or that same energy isn't applied because Latino and Hispanic men are not the subjects of, right, anti-black misandry, right? They are not dehumanized in the same way black men are for being black and for being male, right? All of these efforts to address the problem, these overdue conversations, are just poor excuses, right, to justify people's hatred for black men. And again, while it's angering, certainly, it's never my goal to take the pathology that someone's, you know, firing at me to gather it and then fire it right back. No. Right? I want my people to be free, right? All of my people. So that same mentality we really need to adopt, not just with electoral politics, but in general, right? But of course, the topic right now is electoral politics, right? To understand how certain themes and narratives and messages are really cooked up and constructed a certain way, right? So you get a couple of prominent black men, right, who are not, you know, thorough in any sort of politic, right? Lil Wayne and 50 Cent are prominent examples, right? And then you hyper promote, right, their endorsement or their support for Donald Trump, and that's supposed to represent the general sentiments of black men, of eligible black male voters, right? If you take, I'll end with this. If you take 50 Cent, Lil Wayne, and I'm trying to think of somebody else. 50 Cent, Lil Wayne, and whoever the prominent black male celebrity or entertainer is, right? You take three black men, right, who are Republican or who are not supportive of the Democrats whatsoever, right? That represents, right, or that what the media and what, you know, popular discourse from folks with PhDs and folks who have a lot of TV time, right, and large followings on social media, they would say those three black men, right, represent the general sentiments or the general interests of all black men, right? But let's say I were to say Candace Owens, Diamond and Silk, and Omarosa, that's just three black women. If I were to say, hey, there go three black women who are Republican or who are conservative, they represent the interests of all black women, I would sound crazy, right? I wouldn't wouldn't get very much positive mileage, right? But when you sort of hold up those two, you know, positions or those two issues, right? You see a drastic imbalance in terms of the treatment, right, of the circumstance, right? There is no interrogation, right, of the politics behind a 50 Cent or a Lil Wayne. It's just, oh, niggas ain't shit, black men voting for Trump, what's the world coming to, right? Where that same energy is not directed to the very prominent black women who hold conservative views, Republican views, are openly, you know, open advocates of someone like Donald Trump, right? But there is no there's no mind paid to them, right? Talk, which time? Let me see. What is the pathological commentary of the black men on Kimberly Curtinshaw's panel? Tell us about the nature, college education, the nature of college education in relationship to constructions of black masculinity. That's what they're educated, I thought, or am I wrong? So in regards to the brothers on the panel, let me pull up their names, because I looked at their bios, and what Tonka is referring to is the panel that was organized by Kimberly Crenshaw and the African American Policy Forum just yesterday. It was entitled Black Men for Trump? The Overdue Conversation on Patriarchy and Misogynoir in Politics, right? And what this panel, to answer your question, Tarka, I believe, let's see, the panelists were Wade Davis, Kiese Lehman, Marlon Peterson, and Alvin Starks. I know for a fact that Kiese Lehman is a professor, he's an author. The educational backgrounds of the other panelists were not disclosed. Like, it wasn't, you know, didn't say master's degree in this or PhD in that. So I don't know. I don't, you know, have an answer in terms of those brothers being educated. But on that question, right, of the nature of college education in relationship to the constructions of black masculinity, it's very, very clear. There's a very pervasive lack of a class analysis, a lack of a socioeconomic analysis. And what I mean by that is, when you ask college educated black people what the conditions of black masculinity are, right, there will inherently be a sort of a skew, right, away from a class analysis, unless that individual person, you know, is rooted in a class analysis sociologically, right, or in a political theory background, right? Because the masses of black people don't go to college. They're not in college, right? So what you end up having are, right, middle class, petty bourgeois black men, right, who end up becoming the voices, right? They become the whole embodiments, right, of not just black masculinity, but scholars of black masculinity, right? You can take somebody, for example, Kiese Lehman is a writer, he's an author, right? He's a professor of English, I believe, right? That isn't a sociological background. That isn't an empirical background, right? And again, the other panelists, their educational background wasn't even disclosed. One of the panelists is an inclusion consultant for the NFL. Just that alone demonstrates a particular class interest being protected, right? That there's a clear partition between college educated, middle class, bourgeois, black folks, black men, right? And the masses, right, of poor and working class, right? Oftentimes without high school diplomas certainly without college diplomas, right? Degrees, black men, right? So again, the question becomes, right, the data demonstrate the gender gap is the largest among Latino Hispanic eligible voters. And it's also Latino Hispanic eligible voters who represent the largest minority group. So where are the panels? Where are the IG lives and the red table talks for Latino men? Because if we're going off the statistics, they represent the greatest threat, right, if you want to call it that, to Donald Trump being reelected, right? You won't see that because they're not the targets. They're not the subjects of pathology, right? The anti-black misandry is targeted towards black men and boys, right? You won't find a historically sound justification, right, for the hyper-fixation on black male support for Trump, because there is none. And for there not to be any, the answer is much simpler but much more graver, and that's that the people that are fixating on this problem, right, hate black men. And instead of saying, I hate black men, the, you know, 1,000 of you who vote for Trump, you know, are toxic and you represent the whole population, right? They sort of construct these programs and these panels, these, you know, IG lives and these talks, right, in order to sort of mask the very deep dehumanization and hatred towards, right? Black men in society. So again, I just want to talk about that real briefly. Again, I've organized a document with these articles and with these links, with these data points and things like that. So if you're interested in that, just let me know and I'll share that with you. Definitely, you know, I'm not here to talk on my rear ends, nor am I here to, you know, hold on to all the information or all the data, right? And again, the ultimate goal is not to redirect the animosity or the hatred. No, the goal is to approach, right, the very real conditions and material realities, right, of our people from a very scientific, sociological, and just overall thorough, right, approach, right, from that position, right? We don't engage in any sort of pathology of anybody, right, because we can't render any of our people as being just that way, right? Black men are just violent just because they're toxically masculine, right? Those are very poor and inaccurate and oftentimes dangerous explanations, right, for very complex problems, right? So again, if you want to tap into that document, just let me know and I'll send it your way. But yes, again, it's a circus. And you know, I would just urge us all to not fall subject to the sensationalism of it all and just, you know, grab the headlines and be drawn in to this circus, because, you know, we cannot vote our way out of our conditions, right? Period, point blank. So on that note, I'll say peace, power, respect, and Black power.